Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Inspirations. This is the second segment of the new series of Inspirations. As we said last week, inshallah, we will try to take some time out to live with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the greatest man, have a glimpse at his life, try to get ourselves involved in every event of his biography, to try to live with him and learn lessons from the situations he went through, how he dealt with that, how he responded to all the challenges. Inshallah, we will try to get into that. And as I said last week, before we get into the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to provide some introductions so that we magnify and maximize our benefit from studying the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We said that this week, inshallah, we will talk about the methodology that we will follow in dealing with the seerah. And this methodology actually applies to all historical research. And we will take it from the perspective of Islam. Because what's happening today with the Muslims, that in fact, they, even when they study history, they study it in the light of another perspective. They take, for example, the Western perspective. They take the rules from the Western historical methodology without noticing or that observing the differences between the Islamic history, the different nature of the Islamic history that is totally distinct from the history of other nations. Because in Islam we have something called al-isnad, the chain of narration. This is something peculiar to Islam. No other nation had such a wonderful scientific system of narrating historical events. So today, inshallah, or this week, we will talk about the methodology that we will follow. And these introductions are very necessary, because as we proceed with the seerah, inshallah, you know and you will be aware what we will be doing. Sometimes we will draw lessons. You know where these lessons come from. What's the methodology we follow? Sometimes we will mention certain events that happened, and we will refer and shed some light on some of the weak narrations and the events that are actually they did not happen, or they are considered to be weak narrations and unacceptable in Islam. So you will understand basically what we will be doing. Now let me start with the methodology that we will follow, inshallah, in this series regarding how we are going to deal with this seerah. What's the method that we will follow in taking the events of this seerah from the sources, how we are going to put them together, how we are going to see them and understand them. This is some kind of a glimpse on the methodology that we will follow. Let me start first with the first point, which is the sources. What kind of resources we will depend on? Because when we talk about history, history was handed down to us from certain sources. Now, a great mistake that so many historians fall into is, in fact, they don't pay great attention to the authenticity and the reliability of the sources they depend on. But inshallah, in our research, in this series, we'll try to avoid falling into this pitfall. We will try to restrict ourselves or keep ourselves only to the reliable and authentic sources. Now let me talk about sources. What sources do we have for the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for his biography? The first and main source, and the most authentic, is the book of Allah, the Qur'an. Now in the Qur'an we find so many references to the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we know that Allah revealed down the Qur'an on stages, one stage after the other, according to the events that took place in the life of Muhammad, according to the challenges he had to face. And this is why Allah says in the Qur'an clearly, in more than one occasion, He says that we revealed the Qur'an to you in stages in order to make your heart firm, in order to make you stronger in the face of the events. This is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For example, in the Qur'an we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions certain things about certain battles. The battle of Badr, the battle of Uhud. We find these in the Qur'an. And in some of their events or some of their aspects are mentioned in detail. Let's go before that in time. We find in the Qur'an the stage of prophethood, where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was commissioned with prophethood or was given the revelation. We can see this in the Qur'an, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhal muddathir, or the one who is covered with his with his blanket or whatever, go and deliver the message. Stand up and deliver the message. So we find this in the Quran. And before that, we find the first verse revealed to Muhammad. اقرأ, read. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. So these are indications and milestones in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We find them clearly in the Quran. What else do we find in the Quran? We find, for example, the arguments that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam needed in the face of the opposition of the disbelievers. This is part of his seerah. The opposition he faced from the pagans, from the people of Quraysh, how he dealt with that, what argument he needed. We find this in the Quran. Certain rulings that were prescribed for the Muslims in the Meccan period before Hijrah, like for example standing up for prayer during the night. That is part of the seerah. The different stages of the seerah, we find them clearly in the Quran. And even after Hijrah, the battles are there. For example, the Ghazwa of Al-Ahzab, when all the Arabs, or most of the Arabs actually gathered in order to destroy the Muslims in Medina, which is the battle of the trench, we call it, when the Muslims dug a trench around Al-Medina. We find this in Surah Al-Ahzab. There is a whole surah dedicated for that. Now, so we find the Quran is a very rich reference on the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we regard it the main source. So any of the narrations that go along and agree with the Quran, we take them without any kind of suspicion. We accept them, even sometimes if they are weak and they confirm what happened in the Quran. We mention that these narrations are weak, but we still take them because they agree totally with the events mentioned in the Quran. Now, as we know that this is the first source, and we will depend heavily, inshallah, on it, and we will try to link every event that we deal with to the Quran or to its reference in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now let me just take some kind of digression. Some of the Orientalists, when they dealt with the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because they don't believe that the Quran is a revelation from Allah. They claim that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrote it down himself, or he got it from somebody else. Okay, so this is why they don't consider the Quran, most of them, the main reference. On the contrary, they take from the Quran what they like, and they interpret some of the events that are mentioned in the Quran in the way that serves their own purposes. And they do this with the Sunnah and other references that we will deal with, inshallah. So the first and main reference is the Quran. We will depend heavily on that, because it gives a very clear kind of classification or milestones on the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, what is the second reference that we will depend on? The books of the Sunnah, the books of Hadith, the Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as I said last week, we will only depend on the authentic narrations. We will not take weak narrations. But sometimes, as I said, we will mention some of the weak narrations if they support an authentic narration, or they support an event that is mentioned clearly in the Quran. Now, what are the books that we can depend on? The books of the Sunnah, the books of Hadith. Now we know that we have the six books of Hadith, the main six books of Hadith, Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. And they have what we call the battles of the Prophet, the Maghazi, the narrations on the battles of the Prophet, and some of the narrations on certain events that happened during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there is something we have to pay attention to, that the books of Hadith were focused on the legislative side of Islam, or the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These early scholars of Islam paid great attention to maintaining and to preserving the Islamic law and the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they paid greater attention to the rulings, to the Islamic system, to the Islamic law or the Islamic legislative system. They paid great attention to that. So this is why we find the majority of the seerah are on these issues, and the issues of aqidah, definitely. Okay. So they paid great attention actually on these on the narrations that pertain to the legislative side of Islam. But sometimes we find hints here and there on the life, on the events that happened during the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we will depend heavily on them, inshallah. Okay. Now, what else? What other sources we can depend on? We have, for example, books called the books of Al-Maghazi. Now, what does Al-Maghazi mean? Al-Maghazi basically means, in the Arabic language, it means expeditions or battles. Now, one of the Tabi'een, His name is Muhammad ibn Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, we know he's one of the greatest companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His son Muhammad said that our parents used to teach us the maghazi, which are the battles and the expeditions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as they used to teach us Quran. So we find that the early generations of Islam paid great attention actually to the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all the events that happened during his life. Now the maghazi are totally and solely devoted to mention the life of, or the biography of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They try to mention all the details that pertain to his biography or to his life. This is the difference or the distinction between the maghazi and the books of the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the books of hadith. So the books on the seerah, which are al-maghazi, they try to observe, most of them try to observe the sequence of events and the time. The first events that happened during the life, then so they maintain and they observe the sequence of the events in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, what kind of books, or what is the authenticity of the books of al-maghazi? Yes, the early generations of the Muslims paid greater attention to the books of sunnah, the books of hadith, because they wanted to maintain the sharia. And they did a wonderful job. They did a job that has no equivalent, no parallel in history, in preserving the sharia of al-Islam. Now, but as for the maghazi, the Muslims kept narrating these verbally or orally. They didn't write down the maghazi of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the companions, because they went through all these events, they narrated them to their students and to their children, and their children narrated that to the generations that came after them, and so on and so forth. So the maghazi are the most comprehensive source on the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but we find in them a great deal of weak narrations, and we find in them a considerable amount of authentic narrations. Alhamdulillah, the scholars recently, the scholars of Islam, the Muslim historians, Muslim scholars of hadith, started to give and dedicate more time to studying the books of maghazi and critique the narrations according to the laws of the science of hadith. They would investigate every chain of narration, every person in that chain of narration, and study it in detail in order to verify the authenticity or to prove the lack of authenticity in the narrations. So we find in these books the authentic narrations and the weak narrations. But we say, may Allah be praised. Really, all praise is due to Allah, that recently the scholars, the Muslim historians, they started to apply the, as we said, the rules of hadith on the maghazi, on the books of seerah, the old books of seerah. And they made use of the new historical method that is widespread around the world and among the academics, among the historians, about weighing up historical events. Because we know that the history of the world was not handed down to us through chains of narration. It's all certain narrations by historians. We don't know anything about them, anything about their truthfulness, anything about their reliability, anything about their memory. But most of humanity accept that. But with Islam, we have a more stringent, a more strict system, because the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ is our religion, is our way of life, is our, as I said, it's our history, it's our identity, and it's our future. So the Muslim historians and scholars of hadith paid great attention, alhamdulillah, to that. So now, how did they deal with the weak narrations? They depended on the Quran and the authentic sunnah. All the narrations that are weak, and their weakness is not very strong, and it agrees with the narrations that we find in the Quran and in the Sunnah, and it goes along the lines, the main lines, the patterns of the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ, they take consideration of these narrations, they accept them, but still they mention their weakness, the weakness of the chain of narrations. And this is a wonderful system. Now, no one human being in history has ever had his biography or his life taken care of as the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it shows the love that the Muslims have to this wonderful Prophet. Now, what kind of maghazi or books on seerah do we have? Now, the first one, according to the Muslim historians, they say the first one was written by Urwa ibn Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. We know the companion as Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Now his son Urwa was the first one to write a book on solely dedicated for the sequence of events in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He died in the year 94 after Hijrah. This was the first scholar, Urwa ibn Zubayr, the first one who wrote a book dedicated totally to the life of biography of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then comes after him the son of Uthman ibn Affan. His name was Aban. Aban, the son of Uthman ibn Affan, he died around just after the end of the first century after Hijrah. He wrote another book as well. Then after that came Amr al-Sha'bi, the very well-known scholar. Amr al-Sha'bi wrote a book on the Maghazi, on the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And actually, unfortunately, these books are lost. We lost every trace of them now. We don't have anything about them at the moment. We don't have any copy of them. But still, we say Allah be praised, because Allah preserved the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for him to remain the role model for all the Muslims throughout the ages. Now, these books were maintained and they were taken. All the narrations in them were taken by later scholars. For example, we have Ibn Ishaq. Ibn Ishaq wrote all their narrations, or most of the majority of their narrations, in his book. Ibn Ishaq died around 151 after Hijrah, and then the majority of the book of Ibn Ishaq was actually written by Ibn Hisham. The seerah that we have, it's available in the market, the seerah of Ibn Hisham. So alhamdulillah, the sources of the seerah are preserved and we have them at hand, and we can deal with them according to a very strict and stringent and very organized system or methodology that the Muslim scholars have. Now, what other sources do we have? How can we deal wisely with these sources in order to arrive at an authentic image of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is something we will discuss after having this short break, so stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're still watching Inspirations. Before we carry on, let me remind you of our email address, because this episode is recorded. So please do send your emails to us, your suggestions. We said that we will deal with so many issues, so we need your contributions, we need your comments and your suggestions. Our email address is inspirations@huda.tv. That's inspirations@huda.tv. Now, as I said last week, that this program or this phase of Inspirations needs your engagement. It needs your involvement in everything, inshallah, because alhamdulillah, we said that Muslim entertainment is more educational. It gives us benefit. It serves the purpose of our creation, which is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And alhamdulillah, I'm aware that the viewers of Huda TV are totally different than other channels. MashaAllah, they are totally different. They are distinguished because they have a lot of concern for Islam itself and for the welfare of the channel as well, and for the spread of the da'wah. So I really, as I said, as I have a responsibility in order to try to present the authentic knowledge about the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we will try to present a true image of how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lived, we'll try to get inside all the events, we'll try to be part of every event, inshallah, as if we were eyewitnessing everything. We'll try to do that, but you also have an equal responsibility. That is to keep up with us, and inshallah, try to write down the things that you find need to be addressed. Any point of benefit you find beneficial, write it down and keep it, because knowledge is very precious. And as a Shafi'i said one day, that the only way to maintain and preserve knowledge is to write it down. It's just like a hunt, or like the game that you hunt. Okay, it's very ridiculous to get hold, for example, of some deer and then let it go. You have to tie it. You have to keep it tied so that you preserve it. And knowledge is more precious than anything for us as Muslims. So inshallah, we will try to benefit from that. I will be waiting for your emails. And as I said, at the beginning of every month, the first Saturday of every month, inshallah, we will have a live show. So we will be waiting for your phone calls and for your suggestions. If you have come across a misconception against Islam, a lie against Islam that you find it difficult to deal with, please send it to us. If you find some kind of an Islamic ruling in fiqh that you are puzzled by, or you would like to find the connection between that and the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we promise to do our best to help you in that, make more research and try to link it to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So our approach to the seerah will be inshallah comprehensive and deep, so we get, as I said, maximum benefit, the true benefit of studying the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, just before the break, we mentioned the main sources on the seerah of Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. Now, we say thank you Allah that these sources are all agreed on a very, a very basic pattern of the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The main events and most of the events of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are agreed upon by the seerah. And the main events have been proven by authentic narrations. So alhamdulillah, and all praises for Allah who preserved for us the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so we can achieve and materialize the verse where Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. For Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there is for us the role model, the perfect model for us to follow. And inshallah, we will try to do this. In this show, we will try to achieve this in a very profound way, in a very practical way, and in a very beneficial way. Now, I have to point out that there are some weak sources. These weak sources came later on. They had narrations on the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but a great deal of them are weak and they contradict what we find in the Quran, what we find in the Sunnah, and what we find in the books of Al-Maghazi, or the authentic books of Al-Maghazi, the most authentic books of Al-Maghazi. For example, there is Al-Waqidi, the book by Al-Waqidi and Ibn Khayyat. These books actually are there, but they contain a huge number of narrations. Unfortunately, most of them are weak, or there is some kind of weak narrations are mixed up with authentic narrations. Some narrations are put together, but they refer to totally separate periods or eras during the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We will point out to some of the narrations that are widespread among the Muslims, but they have no basis, no historical basis, no basis in the science of hadith. Now, we have dealt with the first axis, or the first point, in this episode. We will move to the second point, which is something we have to understand as Muslims living in such a state in this century and in this time, about 1400 years after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Muslims are not living in a good state. The Muslims are not living according to the teachings of Islam correctly. Alhamdulillah, there is a lot of good in the Islamic Ummah. There is a lot of hope that we find. There is a lot of knowledge still, and we know that the Muslims have a lot of love for Islam and for their own nation, but still we need to work harder. And we will learn what's the meaning of working harder by seeing the example of Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his companions, this wonderful example. Now, we have to understand history, and we in general, and the seerah in particular, according to the Islamic way of understanding, from an Islamic perspective. Now, this is the second point, main point in our segment today, which is how Muslims should view history. Because unfortunately, we Muslims, and let me say this as a fact, we don't read. We don't really read. We don't read history. We don't read about our current state. We don't read enough in terms of our way of life, in terms of the Islamic system of life, in terms of the Islamic aqidah. And if you look at the statistics about how many books are published in the Muslim world, and how many books, for example, are published in one of the smallest countries in Europe, let's say Belgium, or even Luxembourg, one of the smallest countries in the in Europe, now this small country would be equivalent to all of the books that are published in the Muslim world. It's amazing that the ummah, or the nation of iqra, of reading and of knowledge, does not really read enough. So we have to give more time. We are taken by radio, we are taken by TV and satellite channels. We are taken by all of that, we are taking our knowledge from that, regardless of who is teaching us, unfortunately. And this shouldn't be the case. We Muslims are very specific about who we take the knowledge from. And we have to read. We have to learn more about our history, even about the history of other people, so we know how to deal with them. So now the main point is how we Muslims should understand history. Because we accept what we hear from, especially what we watch and what we see and what we hear from satellite stations and from other sources as well. And most of them depend heavily on non-Islamic sources. And they want to shape our own mind, our own mentality in a certain way. And most Muslims have fallen into this trap. No, we Muslims, we have our own way of viewing history. And it's totally different. And it is wonderful. Because it is the correct way of seeing and understanding history in general and the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in particular. Now the first point, or the first main point in how Muslims, what is the Islamic perspective on history and on the seerah? The first fact is that we see everything that happens in this world, every event that happened in the past, in history, according to the fact of the reality of this world. That this world is only a test, and the real life is that in the hereafter. This is how we see, this is how we view the events of history. So even if some nation achieves great achievements and great civilization, material civilization, and has great contributions to humanity, but all these are material and they do not serve the purpose of the reality of this life, which is that we live in a test, in a life in which Allah wants to see how we will function and operate and how we will worship Him, and then the real life is in the hereafter. It's either in paradise or in hell, alive forever. Now if we don't see history from this perspective, we will totally be off track. We will not understand history correctly. And if you look at the Muslim youth today, this is the trap they fell into. Because they are amazed, they are astonished, they are totally overcome and overwhelmed by the material achievements, by other civilizations, by other nations, and they want to imitate them. They want to follow them in every detail. They want to follow them even in the nasty aspects of their lives, in the lewdness that they have, in the decadent kind of morality, the low morality, the pathetic kind of life that they have. So we won't understand history correctly if we will not understand history correctly if we do not see it in the light of the reality of this life and the reality of this world. This is point number one in the Islamic perspective of how we should view history. So every achievement, we see it in the light of the reality of this life. Even if some people achieved some material achievements in this life, it doesn't mean that Islamically this is perfect. No. It is good somehow, but it has its own limitations. Goodness, we judge the goodness of a nation or the goodness of contributions and the value of contributions to humanity in the light of the reality of this world. Now this is point number one. Point number two is that we view history and we critique history according to the criterions we find and the facts we find clearly in the Quran. Now Sigmund Freud stated it clearly that the human race went through three stages so far. The first stage was worshipping stones and idols, the sun and the moon and the stars. Paganism. He says this is how humanity evolved. The first stage was worshipping idols, statues, the sun and the moon and objects. Then he claims that humanity evolved and started worshipping one God. Then he says later on came a third stage, which is a higher stage according to him, Humanity evolved to the age of science. Now humans worship science. They don't accept one God. They don't accept multiple gods. He is referring actually to atheism. He is referring to belief in no God. He claims that all these are evolutions, that humanity evolves and goes from one stage to a higher stage. And unfortunately, you will find in some of the Muslim historians, and unfortunately some of the writers of the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ at our time, our contemporary writers, some of them are highly affected by these ideas. They believe that originally humanity or humans were worshippers of stones and the sun and the moon and objects. But the Quran tells us something different, that originally human beings are monotheists. They know and they recognize the existence of the Creator, the one Creator, and that they should worship Him alone, and that their life should be centered around that. So who do we believe, the Quran or Sigmund Freud or other people? We believe in what we find in the Quran, because it is from the Creator of the heavens and the earth. So we Muslims have to see the events in the light of this. And as I said, so many so-called intellectuals who claim to be Muslims, who ascribe themselves to Islam, who are mainly originally Arabs, and they claim that they are dealing with history and the seerah according to a scientific method. For them, scientific method means taking these views of, for example, Sigmund Freud and others. We say no. In Islam, we see history, we critique history, and we weigh up history against the Quran. So if it goes with the Quran, that's fine. If it doesn't go with the Quran, we totally reject that. And because it's a human effort, and it's deficient, and it's based on speculation and conjecture, we take the facts from the Quran, because the Quran gives us the true history of humanity. Now, what else do we have? What elements do we have in the Islamic perspective of understanding and viewing history? This is something we will find after having this short break.
We'll talk about Huda, we'll talk about our way. Come join us and have your say, let's talk about our way. Remember you are not alone, Huda is the light in your home. We'll talk about Huda, we'll talk about our way. Come join us and have your
say. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome, you're still watching Inspirations. Before we carry on with the Islamic perspective on history and how we should view history as Muslims, I'll remind you of our email address. We will be waiting for your emails, inshallah, to deal with them, whether you have suggestions or whether you have inquiries or anything you have, inshallah, we will try to deal with all of that, and we would appreciate your help and your support and your contributions. Now, we were talking about the Islamic perspective on history, and that if we do not understand the Islamic perspective and view on history, we will not understand history correctly. We mentioned that we have to view history in the light of the reality of this world, and we have to see the Quran or weigh up history against the facts that we find in the Quran. And we mentioned the statement of Sigmund Freud that humanity went through three stages, but in Islam we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that the first human, Adam, peace be upon him, was upon monotheism. And even after Adam, the people were upon monotheism, as the hadith mentioned in al-Bukhari by Ibn Abbas, that all humanity were upon tawheed, upon monotheism, worshipping Allah alone. But the devils took them away from the straight path, and they made it, actually for 10 centuries or 10 generations, the people were upon tawheed and oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until the devils incited them and misguided them to polytheism and to associating partners along with Allah. And then this is why Prophet Noah was sent. So we have to view history in this light. The third point is actually when we read history, especially the Islamic history, we have to maintain and keep in mind the motives of the behavior of the Muslims. We, especially the early generation, the companions, Now we see some of the Orientalists, for example, let me give an example here by the French Orientalist and priest. He was an Orientalist and a priest, Lamans. He says, for example, regarding the appointment of Abu Bakr as the leader of the Muslims, as the chief of the believers, or the Khalifa of the Prophet ﷺ, he says that it was a conspiracy conducted and planned and plotted by Abu Bakr and Umar ibn al-Khattab. Now he is saying that in light of his own background. You know, we all know about the conspiracies in the French court during the 15th and the 16th Gregorian centuries. So unfortunately, we will find out, inshallah, as we will talk about the misconceptions about Islam and about the history of Islam and about the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will see that most Orientalists, most Western scholars, they carry their culture, they carry their history, and they impose it on the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and on the Islamic history. So, but for us Muslims, we have our own criteria that is taken from the Quran and the Sunnah. The motives now of the Muslims, especially the early generations, for us it is sincerity, because we know they are the best ones who understood that the actions will not be accepted by Allah except when they are done sincerely for Allah. And we know that their main goal and their main, or the goal of their lives, was to achieve success in the hereafter, to get their way into paradise, and that they always wanted to spread justice among humanity. And they always wanted to convey the message of Al-Islam. These are the motives that we know about the early generations of the Muslims, and this should be the case with every Muslim. But with the companions, we know that for a fact, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised them and witnessed for their sound character and for their strong iman. Allah witnessed for that in the Quran clearly. Allah testified in the Quran about that. So let's give some examples. For example, the Rib'i ibn Amr, one of the companions, when the Muslims went to Persia, to open Persia and spread Islam in that area, definitely the Persian army stood in their face, and there was so many big battles, major battles. One day the Muslim leader, the leader of the Muslim army, sent Rib'i ibn Amr to Rustum, who was the leader of the Persians. He came in and he spoke to Rustum. Rustum said to him, "What do you want from us? If you want money, we will give you gold and silver. If you want, for example, women, we will give you the most beautiful women we have in Persia. What do you want? We will give you. Just go back to your desert, go back to your homeland." The man said to him, he said, "We came to you. We came here. We are coming out of the Arabian Peninsula in order to save the people from the darkness of shirk and polytheism to the light of tawheed and unity of Allah. We came to save the people from the narrowness of this life to its vastness and the vastness of the hereafter. We came to the people to save them from the oppression of other ways of life to the justice and the beauty of Islam." So the man said to him, "Why didn't you go back?" He said, "No, we will not go back until you enter into Islam and you accept Islam to govern your land and to bring justice to the people. Oh, if you refuse to do that, then you have to pay the jizya and you have to let the people, let it open for the people to choose whether they want to enter into Islam or not." And he said to him that your accepting Islam is more beloved to us than all your wealth and all your money and all your women. We don't want that. What you want, our main goal is that you enter into Islam. And this, something else, almost the same thing happened with Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba, who was another messenger sent to Rustam as well. He said, "We want you to enter into Islam. This is our main goal. We don't want your wealth, we don't want your money, we don't want your women or anything. All what we want is that you enter into Islam and you let the people open their eyes to the beauty and the justice of their of the religion or the way of life sent to them by their Creator." Now, this is how we should understand the motives of the Muslims, as how they conducted themselves in history. Now, another point that we have that falls under the title of Islamic perspective on history is the meaning of civilization. What is the meaning of civilization? If you ask any average Muslim, what's the meaning of civilization? They would tell you industrial and technological advancement, a strong economy, what else? Things like that, material stuff about this life. But in Islam, the criterion for advancement, the criterion for civilization is not only the material. The material is only one aspect, but the main criterion for advancement, for civilization in Islam, is the worship of Allah. So even if we find today so many nations that are amazingly advanced in terms of material advancement, technological, industrial, and all the aspects of this life, as long as they do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly according to Islam, then for us, this is not advancement, this is not civilization. This is only one-sided, this is a mutilated kind of civilization. So if you ask, most of the Muslims will give you the answer that the civilized world are, for example, Europe and Americas and the Western Hemisphere of the world. Now this is not according to the Islamic perspective on Islam, on history. So how do we expect to grow as a nation, preserving our identity, preserving our way of life, preserving the Quran, preserving the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and spreading the beauty of this wonderful religion to all humanity? How do we expect to play our major role in bringing peace to humanity, bringing Islam to humanity, opening the eyes of the people to the reality of this world? How do we expect to do that if we do not see history in the light or in the perspective of Islam? Okay? How? It is our obligation. It's our duty to see history, view history in the light, which is the right perspective. It's the only right perspective, because people view history in the light of their materialist kind of way of life or mentality. But the only true perspective is the one that is given to us through the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Creator. So we have to view civilization and advancement in this light. This is why we can find a hint of this in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said the best generation or the best century is the century in which I lived, the generation among whom I am present, which is the generation of the companions. Now, what was their advancement? What's their goodness? What was it about? Did they have technological advancement? No, they didn't have at that time. They were somehow average or maybe a little bit behind. But the civilization they had, the advancement they had, was adhering to Islam, understanding the reality of this world, and moral kind of advancement. Now look at the world today. Despite the material advancement they had, what about the moral aspect of their lives? So if we don't govern our understanding of this life, of this world, of history, of the movement of humanity by the Islamic criterion, we will not be able to move even one step forward. Now, another point in the Islamic perspective of how we should view history, how we should understand the story of humanity in general, is that we have a law, which is, there is no justification for events that are proven to be authentic in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the seerah. We are not apologetic. There are certain events that happened in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that were manipulated and they were exploited by the enemies of Islam, and they were magnified in order to cast a lot of doubt on the character of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his integrity, and therefore the integrity of Islam itself. We say we don't have this kind of attitude, which is a defensive attitude. And we Muslims are in the cage of accusation, and we have to free ourselves, free our Prophet, and defend our history from these strong charges. No, Islam does not need our defense. So many people denied facts in the Islamic history, in the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just because they saw that the enemies of Islam have exploited these points. We say no. We do not accept that. Inshallah, when we talk, and hopefully this will be either next week or the week that comes after, how we should deal with the misconceptions and we can limit their influence and their destructive impact on our history and on the history of humanity as in general. We will leave this inshallah for next week or the week that comes after. But for us, we are not apologetic. For example, they would say, so many people say that jihad in Islam is only in state of defense, self-defense. Now, who said that? If we go back to the Quran, to the Sunnah, and the books of the scholars of Islam, we find that this is untrue. Jihad is not only for defense. Jihad is to protect the truth. Jihad is to spread the message of Islam. It's not forcing people to come into Islam. Yes, the Orientalists always manipulate facts in order to bring doubt. No, but we will learn, inshallah, how to deal with all of this, how to have very clear vision. And we will not have a clear vision unless we understand the Islamic perspective on history. And we will see that even though most of the Western scholars, the Orientalists, they claim objectivity all the time. But we will prove from their own books, inshallah, that objectivity is not there. And we will see how they manipulate facts and how they pretend to be objective. Okay, so the final point in how to have a develop an Islamic perspective on history and the seerah is that we have to use Islamic terminology. Now we hear quite often now that we have left, right and center. Now this is not Islamic. And these terms are not precise anyway. They are vague, they are loose. Right, left, far, you know, far left. No. We don't accept this in Islam. In Islam we have good and evil. We have righteous and we have a sinner. We have, for example, Islam, Muslims and non-Muslims. We have this. So we have to stick to this terminology because it is precise. It is divine from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have Muslim, hypocrite, non-Muslim, enemies of Islam, friends of Islam. We have all of these. So we have to maintain our terminology, the Islamic terminology, because terminology means perception, it means mentality, means understanding. Because if we have a distorted terminology, we will not have proper understanding. They are the tools for our perspective, the terminology. The terms that we use are the tools that we use to develop a correct perspective. So we have to stick to the Islamic terminology, inshallah. Now the last point I just want to mention is that history, there are two ways to explain history or to show history. There is minor history and major history. Now, what does this mean? How do historians manipulate historical facts according to these major history, minor history? We will leave this for next week, inshallah, to discuss it in detail so we develop a profound understanding of how to approach history. And you will see, inshallah, the fruits of this methodology as we proceed with the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, until we meet next time, I will remind you now to keep sending us your emails. And now I have to say, I leave you in peace. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hayya hayya hayya.